If you search for tenderness, it isn't hard to find. You can have the love you need to live. You can look for truthfulness, you might as well be blind. It always seems to be so hard to give. Honesty is such a lonely word. Everyone is so untrue. Honesty is hardly ever heard. Can't always find someone to say they sympathize if I wear my heart out on the sleeve. But I don't want some pretty face to tell me pretty lies. 'Cause all I want is someone to be. I can find a lover, I can find a friend, I can have security until the bitter end. Anyone can come for me with compromise again. I know. Sincerity, tell me where else can I turn? 'Cause you're the one that I depend upon. Oh, honesty is such a lonely word. Everyone is so untrue.
You probably noticed the photo booth in the lobby this morning. Let's take a look at some of the pictures we took. Scary. Just the last one. Masks and disguises can be a lot of fun. When it comes to relationships, we know that community requires honesty. When we pretend to be real, there can be no genuine fellowship. 1 John 1, 6 and 7 puts it this way. So if we are lying, if we say we have fellowship with God, but go on living in spiritual darkness, we are not practicing the truth. But if we are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. This morning, we are doing the hard work of being honest to God, real with others, and truthful with ourselves about who we are and what we are. When we see ourselves and one another clearly under God's clarifying and purifying light, we are in a position to appreciate each other, observe the cleansing work Jesus performs in one another's lives, and experience the common ground that creates community. Let's stand and unify our hearts as we celebrate our great God.
Day, isn't it? It's good because God is good and God is everything. So I was thinking when we were rehearsing the song earlier this morning, we were doing How Great Thou Art. And as I was singing, just like my mind started being flooded with all the things to celebrate God for. Not all the things, but some things. And I just thought, man, that's healthy, just to remember who God is and what he's provided. That's something constantly just need to be doing, to remember who he is and who I am through him. And so I just thought, like, even this morning, take a moment, just say, I thank you, God, for. Just thank him right now. Fill in that blank. Thank you for this church, Lord. Thank you for my home. I thank you for this relationship I have with you. Thank you for new life. Thank you for my spouse. Thank you for my children, Lord. Thank you for good food, for vacations and jobs. And thank you for providing, Jesus. We love you. Thank you. Thank you.
When I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. His son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in. Oh, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take. My soul, my Savior God.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare your our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome.
bow your heads with me, let us take a moment to quiet our hearts before God. Will you thank Him for His presence that's here right now? Would you ask the Spirit to speak and minister to you as we pray? Father, we pray for you to put your finger on the places in our lives infected with pretense and false conclusions. Help us to be genuine in confessing our sins, the ones we can see as well as the ones we must be shown. Lead us to others who want to live transparently, and allow us to experience the remarkable fellowship of your presence together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. Being here. I love being together. I love what God's doing. This is our family and this is our community. I thank God for it. If you are visiting this morning, we welcome you. Thank you for joining us. We want you to know that there is a connection card inside your worship folder. If you take time, fill that out, and at the end of the service, you can just turn it in at the Welcome Center. We have a special gift for you. We'd love to connect and meet you. Another way that we're helping build community here at Newark Naz, it's really a fun program. It's called Dinner for Eight. It's a great way to know your family here at Newark Naz. All you have to do is just fill this out. You guys, everybody take a look at it. It's inside your worship folder. You fill it out, and you turn it in at the Welcome Center. It's really that simple. We gather the cards, we pick out names, and we contact you and set up Dinner for Eight. Carol and I did this last week. We're extending it another week because we're the only ones that signed up. No, that's not true at all. A lot of you did, but we wanted to extend it out to the rest of you. And I'm just telling you guys, I don't know if you're like me, but if anything involves food, it's a good thing. Yes? All right. So do that. It's going to be good. You can also sign up online at newarknaz.org. All right, Mega Sports Camp is just around the corner. We're excited. It means that we get to touch the lives of over 500 kids and their families here at Newark Naz and in our neighborhood. That's awesome. Here's what you need to know and how you can be a part of the team.
Good morning, Newark Naz. I'm Seth, and I'm an intern at the church this summer. I want to let you know about an important event that's coming up in just 2 weeks. It's Mega Sports Camp. It'll be from 6 to 8 p.m. from Wednesday, June 24th to Friday, June 26th. Stop it, Kenny! I'm saving myself for Mega Sports Camp! Anyway, sign your kids up if they're from ages 3 years old to 6th grade, and we'll be offering tracks in soccer, basketball, cheer, and volleyball, and we're going to have little all-stars for our preschoolers. We also need about 78 volunteers for each night. If you can help with coaching, being a crew leader, or maybe even you can help with snacks, registration, or transportation, it would be amazing for you to do so. If you're interested in helping or signing your kid up, go to the welcome kiosk at your location and ask how to sign up. Mega Sports Camp. See you there.
No offense to Seth, but I just wish one of those soccer balls would have landed right there. And it made his glasses sort of like turn. Anyways, so I want you guys to also know something that's big that's going to happen following Mega Sports Camp on that Sunday, June 28th. It's our big 10th Sunday, and we're sort of tying in a lot of stuff here. We're celebrating our commitment to our community, so we're inviting all of the families from our neighborhood who participated in Mega Sports Camp, and everyone here, you guys, and we're gonna join each other under the tents in the front lawn after each service. We're gonna have good food, we're gonna have a time to connect on the front lawn. So I probably food excites me too much, but when there's food involved, it's going to be good. So next, it's in a couple of Sundays on the 28th. Just plan on having lunch together as a community out there. It's going to be good. Also, we're celebrating the work and ministry of our summer serve team who have just completed their week's local mission. It's going to be a blast. Lots of stuff happening that day. Don't want to miss it. As the ushers come, we're going to continue to worship by giving our tithes and offerings. Will you bow your heads in prayer with me? Father, we thank you for giving us the opportunity to love and serve you together in unity. We thank you that together we can build your kingdom as we lay down our lives and do what you've called us to do. We willingly say yes to all that you are and all that you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
We all wear masks from time to time, but the craziest place we put them on is in church.
Hello, brother.
Amen.
Greetings to you on this day that the Lord has made.
Something about it makes us want to look our best.
I'm fine.
Sound our best.
He hath blessedeth me so verily.
And make like everything is perfect.
Things are great.
But behind every perfect mask is a perfectly messed up life. People with hearts that are empty, confused, addicted, hopeless, helpless, and hurting. People who think But here's the thing, this is exactly the kind of life where God shows up. Messes are his specialty. The one thing God can't work with is a mask. So around here, we have a saying, it's okay
to not be okay.
Nobody's perfect.
But grace is available.
We believe God doesn't love us if or because.
He loves us anyway.
We all like to look good to others. We like to make a good impression. But when it comes to God, the best impression you can make is to just be you.
Good. Yep, there we are. Sorry, my bad. I think my battery died on me. It is good to see you this morning, and nice to be together. Good to be in the house of the Lord. Last week we talked about the idea of accountability. Today I want us to talk about authenticity. As you may remember, we are discussing this whole concept of being a part of a community. And in these first 2 weeks, we are looking at disciplines or actions or things that we need to participate in our own lives that allow us to be active parts of the community. These next 3 weeks that we have, we will discuss that idea of things that we need to let go of, move beyond, things that we need to get past, so that somehow we can be a part of community. Today, as I talk to you about this idea of authenticity, you'll see that some of what I'm talking to you about is taken from a book by Brennan Manning. It is The Importance of Being Foolish. And is absolutely a beautiful book. I'll take little bitty elements of it and work it into my sermon this morning, but I just wanted you to be aware of that as we discuss all of this. One of the things that I love the most is that idea of kids and their little outfits, the ones that dress up at different times and wear different things. When Katie and I lived in San Diego with the boys, we had season passes to Disneyland. I loved Disneyland, absolutely loved Disneyland. It's supposed to be the happiest place on earth, but it's always fun to wander around and see how many kids are crying and screaming and how many parents are hacked off. It's great. And but part of what I loved is the idea that, now we have boys, but all the little girls that wandered in all their little princess outfits. I love Halloween because I'm not so much of anything goofy other than I love candy. And I love to see all the kids dressed up in their little outfits. It is always intriguing to me as they show up in their little outfits and all the other things that they seemingly have this idea that they are taking on a whole new personality, a whole new way of life, that suddenly when they put on the mask, they put on the cape, that they have superhuman powers and they have the ability to become something that the rest of us know that they're really not. In much the same way, authenticity does the same thing for us. It invites you and me to take off the mask, to take off the cape, so to speak, and somehow come to the understanding and the realization that what's really important is that we're honest with ourselves and honest with the community of faith that we are a part of. As we look at that today, I want us to begin by looking at Proverbs. Proverbs has a passage where the writer of Proverbs talks at length about, or just real quickly, about this whole idea of honesty and truthfulness. It says this, Proverbs chapter 12, verse 17. Whoever speaks the truth gives honest evidence, but a false witness utters deceit. Now, as we begin today, you'll find that not only are we talking about it now, but I'll return back to this passage as we close out this morning. This idea that our lives are to speak truthfully and honestly about who we are. Now, one of the things that happens so often in our lives is that when we begin to talk about this concept of transparency and honesty in the framework of our lives, there are three things that often keep us, three aspects, three basic human desires that keep us from truthfully and honestly being an authentic people. So I want to talk to you this morning as we begin about these three aspects that keep us from being authentic people. And then as we do that, you got something to tell me today? My mic's cutting out? Yeah, I bet you do.
Brian says he wants to hear every word.
Let's see here. Is that better? Okay. So as we talk about this idea of authenticity and the basic human desires that keep us from being authentic, I want us to begin with this concept of simply security. Security is one of those things that you and I long for. It is one of those things that each of us believes that we need in the framework of our lives. One of those things that all of us strive for. That sense that somehow I have security in my life. That I know that the sun will come out tomorrow. Thank you, Annie. And that somehow, not only that, but that there's a roof over my head, that I have food on my table, that I have a job, that I have security, that this security in my relationships and regards to my life provide me with this deep sense of things. And that security and that need for security in our lives often drives us to a level of control. The ability to control things, to dictate things, to guarantee that somehow that if I can control it, then that security is an active part of my life. That security and that control in my life often move me to the point where I begin to believe that somehow if I can just do enough, if I can just make it work, if I can just somehow control and dictate all of this, then everything will be all right. One of my dearest friends was a gentleman who was in his mid to late 80s. He was a man who was a mentor and a man who I found to be one of the great saints of the church. He was an ordained elder in the church, and I found myself weekly sitting with him, laughing and telling stories and asking questions and trying to gain insight about how life should be lived and how as a pastor I should be doing things. I remember one day sitting with him in San Diego. We were sitting together that day. His wife's health was failing and she wasn't doing very well. His kids had already taken away her car keys and were on the verge, it appeared, of taking his. And all of life seemed to be coming unraveled at some level. All the things that he believed provided him the highest amounts of security were disappearing. We sat there that day and we began to talk through all of it. And as we talked through of it, great big tears began to roll down his cheek. And he said to me, "Scott, what if I haven't done enough? What if I haven't done enough for her? What if I haven't done enough for him? What if I haven't done enough for the church? You see, at some level, you and I, whether we want to admit it or not, find ourselves deeply concerned about the security that we believe we have to have in life. That basic human desire drives us and keeps us from being authentic people. But there is a second human desire that often keeps us from being all that we could be. It is that sense and that need of pleasure, or the desire, best way to put it, is for our own happiness. That basic desire in life, the belief that somehow it is all about me being happy, it is all about me having my pleasures and my desires met, that keeps us from being authentic people. When our own desires and our own passions and our own wants begin to move to the place that those things drive us, then it's not only important for us to be happy, but it is important for the entire world to see us as happy. And that happiness keeps us, or that desire to be happy keeps us from being authentic people. That human desire of pleasure, that human desire to have my needs met, that somehow all of this happiness is about me. In some cases, it's not just about my own happiness, but it is about my own physical desires. Now, often when we think of that, we think of sexual desires. And sometimes that's the truth, that our sexual desires, our sexual happiness drives us and dictates things to a place and to a point where we try to present ourselves as anything but authentic. But sometimes it's not even just the sexual desires. Sometimes it's even those other appetites that take control of our lives, those things that somehow dictate things to us. One of my favorite quotes is by a cardinal in the Catholic Church. He says simply this. His name is Cardinal Wolsey. He says, "Would that I have served my God the way that I had watched my waistline." What a wonderful statement. Just simply saying that for him personally, he spent more time worried and concerned about his own physical happiness at times than he did about what it meant to be an authentic servant of Christ Jesus. Now, there's a third desire, a third thing that we all seek, this idea of what it is that we're all longing for, this human basic desire that all of that keeps us from being authentic. It is the need for power. Power often drives us. Power is that deep sense that somehow I have something that you don't have, whether it is control, or in many cases for some of us it's knowledge. You remember the old story, the old line, knowledge is power. Now, sometimes when we hear that, we think of the fact that, well, if you have more book smarts than the other person, then you have power. But power is not limited solely to book smarts. That knowledge is sometimes I know something that you don't know. I know something about someone that you don't know. I have information that you don't have. And because I have that information, or because I have that knowledge, then I get to manipulate the situation in my favor. I get to manipulate things in a way and in a fashion and in a form where I can use power to squish you. I can use power to hold you at arm's length. I can use power to present myself in such a way that you see something that is not the real me. Now, those three basic human desires often keep us from being authentic people in community, in fellowship, in relationship with Christ and His church. But there are things and ways that we can live that allow us to overcome those three basic human desires. Those things are done in a very simple way. So how do we overcome this lack of authenticity? Thanks for asking today. I appreciate it. Here is first and foremost, by living out the life of Christ. Now, this is done primarily by being what I would call, better way to say it, if not living out the life of Christ, is by being imitators of Christ. You'll see that in the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul writes constantly. And when he gives these commands in these letters that he writes, these epistles, he says, be imitators of me as I imitate Christ. Or as he says in Ephesians chapter 5, be imitators of God. This idea of imitators is what God calls us to, what Christ calls us to, what Paul reminds us of. You see Christ calling us to that in Matthew chapter 12. Now, in Matthew chapter 12, he does this primarily by encouraging us and challenging us to be people who are humble, people who give up pride and arrogance. And that is done, first and foremost, Jesus does that in Matthew chapter 11, not 12, pardon me, by saying, come unto me, take my yoke, for I am gentle and humble. So one of the easiest ways that you and I begin to imitate the life of Christ is by becoming humble people, by giving up arrogance and pride. And what Jesus begins to say to us in Matthew chapter 11 is the very idea and the very concept that he is saying to us. If you yoke your life with mine, if you tie your life with mine, if you connect your life with mine, then you become a humble and a gentle spirit. A person who begins to imitate their life like he lives his life. Now, the Apostle Paul says it to us in Philippians chapter 2 in this wonderful and beautiful way that you and I have read and seen before. Paul says it this way, your attitude, my attitude, our attitude, should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who made himself nothing and humbled himself, taking on the very nature of man, is what it goes on to say. In other words, what Paul is challenging us to do and reminding us is that when we are imitators of Christ, our attitudes, our actions, and our lives are lived in humility for him. So becoming an imitator of Christ means a humble spirit, a life lived in humility for him. But there's a second part of this that it means for us to be imitators of Christ, or those who live out the life of Christ. It is done in truth and honesty. Now, this truth and honesty sometimes can be a challenge for us. Let's be truthful about it this morning. We like to think that that's not always the case. I always love the little kid who stands there with their bangs cut really, really short and the hair sprinkled all over their shirt and the scissors in their hand, only for us to ask, who did this? I don't know. Come on, really? Or the little kid that stands in the hallway with the crayons in their hands and they've drawn the big picture on the wall of the hallway and you say, who did this? I don't know. And you want to say, really? You're holding the crayons in your hand, kid? Come on. Now, the truth is, that's often how we live. But Jesus speaks to us in a more intimate, real, and honest way about this idea of truthfulness. Now, I'm going to talk to you about that this morning. And as he does it, I want you to see that they're all taken from the book of John. In the book of John, Jesus talks to us very directly about what it means for us to be people of truth. Now, the first one you see is this. He says, John chapter 4, true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Now, when we hear that, we often understand this idea of spirit. Spirit for us means that in the deep sense that the Spirit is in this place. It goes back to the idea and the concept of what we sung about this morning. When we sang about that idea of Holy Spirit come into this place, that we understand. But this idea of truthfulness is the concept or the idea of authenticity, the ability to take off the mask and be truthful about where I am, who I am, what's going on in my life, asking God to see me and to know me and to search me. It is that sense where somehow, know me in the most intimate ways. Help me to understand that, God. Now, part of that begs the question for you and for me is, what kind of worship would we have if when we entered in every week, we entered in an authentic, honest, truthful way, removing the mask and saying, this is me. This is what's going on in my life. This is where I'm at, God. If we had those two or three people in our lives that we just consistently and constantly said, honestly and truthfully, this is where I'm at. I'm struggling. We're struggling. I'm hurting. This is what's going on. Now, there's a second part, or second verse in John that I want you to see today. This is what Jesus says in John chapter 8, verse 32. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Now again, if this truthfulness is also the concept of authenticity, the concept that somehow I'm being honest about my own life, then you and I begin to understand that part of truthfulness means that when I am honest and authentic about who I am and what is going on in my life, that there is freedom, real freedom found in the ability to be truthful, not to have to put on a mask, not to have power to manipulate, not to have security to control, not to have somehow have to believe that all of this is about my own pleasure and my own joy, my own happiness. That when I begin to live there and honestly say, this is where I'm at, this is what I'm struggling with, then I can find freedom, real freedom in Christ Jesus. That's part of what Jesus is saying to you and to me in that passage. There's another passage that he gives us out of the book of John. It's this one. He says in John chapter 14, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Now in this, he says to you and to me, as simple as it is, if you model your life after me, if you follow me, if you imitate me, then you find the way to true life. Life as it was meant to be lived, not with a mask, not with power, not solely for my own pleasure, and not simply seeking my security. Now there's an additional passage that he says, and I want you to see it today. It's in John 16. In this he says, but when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. Ultimately, what he's saying here, what he's reminding us of here, is that the Spirit working in your life and in my life ought to be able to speak truth about who we are, where we're at, what is going on, and how we are living. Now, as we think of that, there's this last moment where truth is mentioned in John. And it's one of the more intriguing ones. It's said by Pilate. Now, Pilate, is Jesus is standing before Pilate, and Jesus is just hours away from being crucified when Pilate asked Jesus this simple question, what is truth? Friend, hear me today. Sometimes I think you and I, Pilate, the rest of us, we're no different than the kid who stands there with the scissors or the kid who stands there with the crayon. When truth is asked of us, we often respond, I don't know. When in reality, what you and I are invited into is a truthful, life-changing relationship with Christ Jesus, where our lives are lived in authentic ways with both Christ and his church. Now, overcoming these human desires that we've talked about in living an authentic relationship is found in that ability to imitate Christ, living out the life of Christ. But it's also found in living out the lordship of Christ, or continual conversion, or the better way to say it is holiness. We don't often talk about holiness in the church, not as much as we should. But holiness is that ability to understand that somehow God is moving me to the place that my life is being lived as it should be, as it was intended to be, that somehow God is transforming me. Now, what that means for you and me, the writer of Psalms reminds us. The writer of Psalms says it this way: O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. He goes on to say, search me, O God, and know my heart, and see if there is any offensive way in me. You see, ultimately what the writer of Psalms is asking for. The writer of Psalms, understand this, already has a relationship with God, a working, moving relationship with God. And yet what the writer of Psalms is asking and saying is, God, know me. Know me more. Know me deeper. You know me in ways that I do not know myself. Search me, O God, and point out to me those things that I need to know better about myself. Those things about my own life that need to change. Socrates, or if you're a big fan of Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, Socrates. Socrates, the philosopher, says, know thyself. What the writer of Psalms reminds us is that the only way we really know ourselves is by continually asking God to search us, to know us, to reveal to us, to put his hands and his fingers and his mark on our lives, for his Spirit to speak into our lives in such a real and dynamic way that somehow the actions, the attitudes, the desires, the thoughts, the things that are destroying our lives are removed. And that somehow our lives are continually being made new, continually being restored and drawn to him, continually our lives are being transformed. You see, ultimately, friends, authenticity means that I've taken off the mask, that I've said to God, God, you already know me. I need to know myself better. Authenticity says to the community of faith and to the church, I need you to see me for who I really am. Because the great God of the universe is transforming my life. And if he can do it for me, he can do it for you. When Katie and I first got married, she came into the marriage with these two beautiful little diamond earrings. Katie's mother had passed away when she was an early teenager, and later in her teenage years, her father came to her one time and gave her these two diamond earrings. He said to her, these are or were your mother's earrings. I want you to have them. They are your mother's diamond earrings, and they mean a great deal to me, and they will mean a great deal to you. They have value, significant value. So you need to protect them. You need to guard them. To be careful with them. Make sure that you watch over them. After Katie and I had been married for several years, we decided that it was time to have her jewelry insured. And so we took all the jewelry in. I really don't have anything other than a wedding ring that I lose quite frequently, it seems like, and I'm constantly having to hunt down. But she has a lot of jewelry. And so we took it in, we got it, you know, had them look at it and tell us what all of it was worth. And then they sent us back this little letter. The little letter had all of the jewelry in it, her wedding ring, a bracelet that she had that her mother had given to her, all this stuff. And when you got to the bottom of the page, there it was. When we read it, we both started to laugh. The line that we believed would say, two diamond earrings with the value associated to it. Instead of saying that, it said two cubic zirconians and the value associated with it. We giggled. We told her father. Her father didn't laugh nearly as hard as we had laughed. He'd been snookered. And what he thought he had was not at all what he really had. The value of what he thought he had was nothing compared to what it was really worth. You see, friend, hear me. My fear is this, is that for many of us within the framework of the church, we want community, but what we want to wear is something that we believe says everything's perfect. This is really valuable. My life has it all together. And instead, what we really have is something that's not worth at all what we think it is. Inside, as you came in today, you got a little card. There it is, right there. It simply says this: what mask am I wearing? You see, friend, I think here's the deal today. The question for you and for me is this: what is it? Is it power? Is it pleasure? Is it security that keeps us from being authentic with the people around us? Because, friend, hear me. The God you and I serve knows you, knows your heart, knows your life, your strengths, your weaknesses, your faults, your failures, your joys, your concerns. Do you know yourself? Have you been honest with yourself and honest with the community in such a real and dynamic way that the great God of the universe can transform you? Maybe it's time to take off the mask. Maybe it's time to be honest, truthful, transparent, authentic. You want community. I want community. But part of it begins by being authentic with myself, with Christ, and with His church. So our prayer today as we sing, my prayer for you, is found in that passage, it's at the bottom of the card today. Psalm 139. Search me. Search me, O God. Let's stand and sing together.
Every word.
Most of the time when I stand up here at the end, I say, may God bless you and keep you. Today, this is all of us. This is me, as much as you. May God the Father search you. May He search your heart, your mind, your spirit. May His Spirit so touch your life this week that you, my friend, could live as an imitator of Christ Jesus to a world who desperately needs to see the truth, the honest, transparent truth that you live into, authenticity. God bless you. Go in peace. I'll see you next week.